This week, Three Sides of the Coin, special guest, their last name, Criss. And it's not Ruth.
Although Mark would like that right now. After 7 o'clock, we're keeping him from his meal.
Actually, I think Mark would love to interview Ruth Criss.
Oh, I would. I love her steaks.
This is Three Sides of the Coin, talking all things KISS.
I want to rock and roll all night.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
So you love the show. Go to itunes.threesidesofthecoin.com and leave your review and rating of Three Sides of the Coin. Thanks.
One, two, three. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Three Sides of the Coin. I am one of the three co-hosts. Michael Branville, Tommy Summers, Mark Cicchini. So let's just keep this intro really quick because we got a long interview with a special guest today. Almost 2 hours. And the last name is Criss. The last name of this guest is Criss.
Do I need it's not more? Ruth. Ruth.
Leave it to Mark to think of food.
Yeah, we're interviewing a steak. It is getting about that time, isn't it?
It is. Yeah. It is. Fucking 7 o'clock. I want to eat fucking dinner.
Mark is like a dog. He just knows what time it is. It's like food.
Can you imagine how brutal it would be if we did this at like 7 in the morning before he could eat breakfast?
Oh, I'd be fine. I'd be way better at that time because I'm up super early. You know, it's just like right now, it's fucking 7 o'clock. I ate lunch at like fucking 11:30. I ate lunch at like fucking 7 hours or whatever. Fucking, I'm like, you know, I just want to fucking
feel
eat
his
now.
Body starting to eat itself. All right, let's just keep this short to the point. I don't think there's any homework. Nothing's happened in the KISS world, Tommy.
No, but there is something that I wanted to say that is kind of to a point you made a long time ago, and it really struck me. I went and saw Bruce Springsteen last night, and I'd never really seen him before. And what really caught my attention was there was no screen. Now, they had a couple of video screens up high up in the corners, but there was no video screen on stage. It was wide open because they had sold the seats behind the band. But the lighting rig reminded me of the 70s bands, and it was really interesting how having that stripped down performance was so much like even the Badlands thing that I would love to see KISS go out on tour and not have a video screen behind them and focus more on the band itself, because it was actually equally as entertaining, if not more, because you spent more time focusing on what was going on than what was going on around you or in front of you. And I wish they would just take a look at how he's doing things and incorporate some of that, because I think that it's become, the technology has kind of almost overtaken the performance for a lot of bands, not just them.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I agree. Totally agree.
Yeah. You know,
I had the same experience on last time I saw Bob Seger. He didn't have a Bob and his band, you know, the Silver Bullet band. And I had the same, exactly what you're feeling right now is what I felt. I walked away going, you know what? That screen, I'm glad there wasn't this, because you're so used to it now. You know what I mean? So many bands have, you just concentrated on the band and the music. I totally agree, Ty. I know how you're feeling today. I had that same feeling when I walked out of the Seger show.
Yeah, I've seen two what I would call stripped down real KISS concerts, meaning makeup plugged in, but it was Alaska and Las Vegas at the Palms. And it was literally just a drum on a riser, a few amps, and a logo. And it was just like, wow, it's just like seeing a band in the 70s.
I would love to see him do that, because that's what I was thinking. I was thinking, how cool would it be if they did this and then they hung the old KISS logo behind them? I would love to see him do something like
cheesy,
that. Just
not the hot in the shade piece of shit.
No, the real one from the 70s. Yeah. You know, I don't know. I would love to go back there for something like that. And then I started thinking about the Destroyer stage and how simple that was, even the Dynasty stage.
The Destroyer one's the one I want to see them resurrect most. It'd be so easy to do. You know, it's sad they don't. I mean, that is just so, that would be so epic to see, because the Destroyer tour itself, and I've said this before, it didn't tour that hard. Not, you know, it'd be,
right.
There's big cities it didn't go to. Detroit was one of them. You know, I would love to have seen the Destroyer tour with the tree and, you know, that would have been freaking awesome. But anyways, we have a special guest today.
Yeah.
Yes,
I told
you
the last
hungry.
Name was... Yeah, Mark's hungry. Listen to Mark. Come on. Let's go. Wrap it up. 2 hours. 2 hours almost with this special guest. Lydia Criss. Okay, go eat, Mark. You can eat for the next 2 hours. We'll meet back here after dinner and we'll do our wrap-up.
There we go.
Keep it going.
He'll be napping.
Yeah, he'll be food coma. Lydia Criss on Three Sides of the Coin.
Take Three Sides of the Coin with you anywhere. Download your 5-star rated free smartphone app today and listen on your Android or Apple smartphone. Visit android.threesidesofthecoin.com or ios.threesidesofthecoin.com.
So I want to introduce, this is a great honor, I want to introduce Lydia Criss. And I don't know, do I need to explain to anybody listening who Lydia Criss is?
I sure hope not. For Christ's sakes, tune out.
If you need to be told who Lydia Criss is, hit the stop button and go somewhere else. I mean, just listen to her last name, Criss. There you go. Let's figure that one out. Lydia, it's a great honor to have you on the show.
It's my pleasure to be here. Yeah.
And you are, I mean, you've had such an active part in the KISS world for so many years.
Yeah, I know. I actually thought it would, it did end at one point. I mean, it slowed down at one point, and then it started back up again. Like there was a time where, I guess it was the entire 80s, I really never saw KISS. I saw Eric Carr's first show and Eric Carr's last show and nothing in between. I was remarried, and I guess that's part of the reason I didn't follow KISS that much. They weren't really, I guess it was when they unmasked and stuff like that. And I remember them not doing as well as when I was married to Peter. You know, like they were playing smaller venues and stuff like that. But
it's funny. Once you're in the KISS family, you can never leave.
I know. That's what Eric Singer once told me. He says, "No, you're part of the family.
Whether you like it or not, you are here for life."
I know. And you know, I mean, I had no intentions of doing a book, but the fans, you know, they talk you into it, and that makes you stay in with everything that's going on also, you know, because, you know, you're constantly being emailed by, you know, all the fans and the Facebook stuff. So I get thanked a lot for.
So just Mark loves to say timeline is so important in everything we talk about. So, when did you first meet Peter? When did you start becoming part of the KISS family? Because it goes way back.
Well,
right?
actually, I met Peter in 1966, so it's way before KISS. I was married to him for, well, we went out for 3.5 years. Then we got married in 1970. And then what just didn't happen until the very, very beginning was, I think the phone call from Gene was in 1970, the summer of 72. So I was already with Peter for 6 years.
So you just so everybody knows, you've been there from the beginning, literally the first moment, the moment the flame first ignited for KISS.
Yeah, I answered the phone when Gene called to answer Peter's ad in Rolling Stone.
So if you would have hung up right then, things would have been different in this world.
I guess so.
I don't know, good or bad, but they would have been different.
Yeah.
Well, you know one thing, and I love your book. This is Tommy, by the way, because you're not on with us, but by phone. We've met a couple of times. I love your book, but it's been a while since I've read it, so I apologize in advance if a few of the questions we're asking you will be redundant, but there's some things I just don't remember. But before before we get into that segment like we discussed to talk about today, one thing that was always curious for me is being that you always loved music to start with, from what I understood, and you like Zeppelin, you go out and saw a lot of concerts. When they first started wearing the makeup, I know there was a lot of that going on in New York, and now many years later, because of YouTube, I've seen so many clips of different bands that never made it that had a lot of face paint on that was somewhat similar to what they were doing in the glam thing. Did you did you ever look at it and go, okay, this is going to be a great thing, or did you ever feel like, well, this could be a hindrance to what you're trying to do?
Well, I looked at it, I was still working at the time. And I looked at it like, how am I going to explain this to my job? How am I going to explain this to my family? It was not a normal thing. It wasn't like it is now. It was known, there was, David Bowie was out, and, the New York Dolls and Alice Cooper. But they weren't known to my family, my mother and father, my parents. I mean, I said, how am I going to explain this? And, little by little, I guess they accepted it. Even my job, they thought it was kind of a little off the wall, but...
I think it's good to remind, because we've got a lot of very young listeners to our show. I mean, fans who came into KISS, in the 90s and 2000s. Back in the 70s, the early 70s, when KISS first formed, there truly was people who thought KISS was evil, demonic. It was extremely shocking.
Yeah.
Today, like you said, it's looked upon like, it's a Disney character at this point in time.
Uh-huh.
It's safe and everybody knows what it's about. But back then, yeah, especially parents were like, jaw dropping. It's like, what? No way. That guy's wearing
crazy bat makeup.
Yeah.
They thought it was the Knights and Satan service and the KISS, and then they were burning albums just like they did that with the Beatles too. At one point when John Lennon had said, something like, we're more popular than God.
Yep.
Or something like
that. Yep. So when you're thinking about how you're going to explain this to your job and to your family, back then that was a real concern. I mean, KISS was not a band that people just looked at and go, oh, that's okay, that's cool. I mean, it was just like people were shocked, to put it mildly.
Yeah. Yeah, the only people that I guess that really thought it was cool were the very young kids, because they looked at them like superheroes.
Right. Well,
you know,
it was something totally different.
Yeah.
Yeah, but early on that wasn't the case, though. I'm talking early on, and Lydia, I kind of feel for you because I'm from a big Italian family too, Catholic, the whole nine yards. So I'm sure some of the things that you were seeing for the first time, your husband wearing makeup and. To the family, I'm sure that was like, oh my God, And it's
funny. It was
bad
enough that he had long hair.
Go ahead.
to my family. You know, none of my, I mean, I have four brothers, and none of them had long hair. So that was a shock. And being that I'm the only girl, you know, it's like I was basically the black sheep of the family. And, you know, it took a while for my parents to even accept the long hair, and then to see the makeup after that, you know, that was another shock. But in the long run, basically, my mother and father, you know, realized how popular they actually were, and, you know, of course, then they were proud of them.
Right.
You know, I mean, the fans used to knock at my parents' door and ask for autographs and albums and stuff. And I remember I have a friend that I see every now and then at KISS events, and he said that he lived in my neighborhood, and he said my mother used to give out free albums from the window. They owned
crazy.
A home in Brooklyn, and, you know, my mother used to open the window and give out free albums to the fans. I know another thing my mother used to do after they became famous, is like we had a cat, Matus, and we used to drop him off by her whenever we would travel. So we'd come in a limo and we dropped the cat off, and my mother eventually got to the point where she was telling the fans when we were going to show up. And they'd be standing there waiting for autographs, and we had to tell her to stop doing that. It was like she had the whole neighborhood waiting for the limo to arrive.
I thought you were going to say something like she would invite the neighborhood kids over to get pictures with the cat.
Well, that might have happened. You never know. Never know.
Think about that. Getting a picture with the cat that influenced the cat in KISS. That would be awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
I have another follow-up question.
Yeah.
Being that you are married to someone who is now famous, and maybe you can't make this parallel, I'm not sure, but I've always was curious, too, what was it like for you, or how different was it that here you knew all four of them, you're married to one of them, and you interact with them on a regular basis, yet all these people, millions of people who are fans of theirs, have no idea what they look like. Was that also kind of strange for you too? Or was that just another part of the fame?
No, I actually, you know, I mean, I looked at them like regular guys in the band with Peter. I didn't really look at them as famous musicians. I mean, to me, they were like my brothers. And, you know, knowing that what they look like without the makeup, I mean, it just was an everyday thing. That was, you know, kind of, you know, that was the way it was. It was weird seeing them with the makeup. That's what was weird.
Okay. I guess I was thinking more of it from a standpoint of it's like being that you looked at them because they're your, you know, like brothers and friends. Was it even more of an odd element because of the fact that no one knew what they looked like? It made it all the stranger, I guess. Like if you, like you're walking with Peter, you guys are going to a restaurant, he's famous at this point, and you guys can go in and sit down and have dinner, and people have no clue that they're maybe sitting 10 feet away from someone who they idolize.
Right. I know. I used to like that, actually. That worked for us and against us at times. You know, like for us, because we could do kind of whatever we wanted, but then against us is one time we went to Madison Square Garden, and I think we went to go see Fleetwood Mac, and Peter had already played the Garden, and nobody back there knew who he was. So they weren't treating him with a lot of respect, whereas they were treating lesser known people like gods, you know, like, oh, you know, like come into the hospitality room and help yourself to some food and stuff like that. Whereas, you know, Peter and I just stood in the hallway.
Well, don't you just want to go, I'm Peter Criss, for Christ's sakes, people. I mean, didn't you ever
think
just
eventually
be like,
he did.
You should just go to shows in makeup.
That would have been great. Oh, it's Peter.
That's funny.
All right, so Lydia, what we wanted to kind of focus on here was, rather than the many years that you've spent in the KISS family, a little period right around KISS Alive, sort of like right before and right after, and getting your take on sort of that, because that was kind of that was the tipping point, you might say.
It was a changing point.
Sorry about that. Needed to talk a little quieter here. I'm in a new office now, so.
Oh.
So prior to a lot, that was a tipping point, and things changed. Big time change. I mean, things exploded.
Oh, yeah.
So what was it like right before that happened?
Well, I was still working at the time. And I know KISS was on the road a lot. I would try to go see Peter as much as I could. And I remember, there were times where, it got pretty lonely on the road, and Peter was, depressed, and he wanted me to come out and see him. I don't really remember where he was. I think it was maybe St. Louis. And I had asked my boss for some time off, I think it was like Thanksgiving weekend. And they said no, because one of my other bosses had just had a heart attack. So they were shorthanded. And, I had to kind of weigh what was more important to me, my job or my husband. And I just said, it's my husband. So I called from the airport, and I said, the day that I wanted off, I just wanted the Friday off. And they said, no, I couldn't have it. So I called them from the airport and said, I'll see you Monday. I'm taking it. And I eventually got fired because of that. But I got fired the exact day that it was the day after my birthday in 1975. And it was the day Alive went gold.
Wow.
So for Alive, things weren't that great. If Alive didn't go gold, they were probably going to be dropped from the record label. That was kind of their last hope. And I guess because it was so expensive to keep them on the road that their albums weren't paying for it. It wasn't paying for the crew and the equipment and everything. So that really made KISS more famous. And that, I think also Cadillac Michigan was a big event. That was right before Alive went gold. But Peter was, he'd come home and he'd tell me, something's changing. He says, all of a sudden the girls are, they're like screaming, and the guys are jumping on the limo, and they're acting like, the fans are acting like we're the Beatles, and because that's what we grew up with. And Peter says something is just totally changing. And I don't know, I guess it was the fact that Alive was a success, the album.
Now, you mentioned that, and we pretty much all know that, as you said, if Alive didn't break, Casablanca probably was going to disappear. They probably lose their record deal. But at that point in time, before that change started to be recognized, was there actually any feelings within the band of like, well, maybe this isn't going to work? Should we just pack the band up as well? Or was there...
Oh, no, not that I know of, no. No, because they knew deep down. I mean, it really takes a while for a band to make it, and they really kind of made it pretty quick. At least to get a record deal. Usually bands, sometimes they could be out there for 5-6 years before they get a record deal. I mean, they got a record deal within a year of them being together. So they just still felt, you know, they always felt any stage that they played, they had to act like it was Madison Square Garden. That was their thing. It was like, you got to play your absolute best. And they felt they were doing that. And, you know, I don't know what deep down in their hearts felt, you know, they felt, because I didn't discuss it with them. But as far as Peter, he never came, you know, he never indicated that they felt they should break up. He never told me that.
I want to go back to your Beatles comment, because it's a band that all of us love, and that's a great way to segue into this.
Don't speak for me.
Oh, other than Michael. Michael's the only person on the planet who doesn't love the Beatles. My question to you on this one, Lydia, is being that you saw the hysteria for the Beatles, and you could relate to it as a fan and liking the band, do you feel at any point while you were around that the four of them, or even just Peter, understood and appreciated how people felt that way towards them in the same way you or people felt that way towards someone like the Beatles? Did that ever sink in? Did he ever get that?
I think so. I think so. You know, the only problem with KISS is that they weren't really respected by the people like the Beatles and the Zeppelins and the, you know, the Who. They weren't, you know, they were, now they are, but in those days they weren't. I always remembered that, you know, they were considered in the industry like, you know, a joke. You know, that they weren't.
You're saying not just the business industry, but the other bands also.
The other bands, yeah.
Looked
yeah,
down
they
on them.
Never really, yeah, they never really, you know, acted like they were, you know, as famous as they were. I mean, now you've got to give them any, you know, some sort of credit. They've been around for 40 something years, so they've got to, you know, I mean, I know that, that. I'd say, like, you know, McCartney and say Ringo, you know, I know they've been associated with KISS in some way, you know, I mean, at least that's what Peter had told me years ago. But, you know, like, I mean, I've spoken to Jimmy Page, and he's asked how Ace was, and, you know, I mean, I told Ace that, you know, Jimmy was asking for him, and Ace was like, you know, Jimmy said my name.
See,
so Ace is still, you know, he still has his, you know, his favorites. I mean, I asked him who his favorite guitar player was, and he told me Jimi Hendrix. So we can't get Jimmy's opinion, but,
right.
You know, at least I know Jimmy Page is friends with Paul Stanley, and, you know, so now they're at least accepted into the industry, by the industry.
Hierarchy.
Lydia, do you recall any...
I have a question.
Go ahead, Mark.
It's an Ace question. I've always wanted to ask you. Now, Lydia, I met you many, many, many times at all the expos and stuff, but one of my favorite picture sessions in your book is when they're in the pool back at the, you know, when they're just, you know, starting out and everything. And
Yeah. Basically
what I wanted to know from you, because they all, you know, that I love those pictures where they're, you know, chicken fighting in the pool. But what was your first impression of Ace? Because, you know, everyone, the polarization of KISS, meaning Gene and Paul on one side and Ace and Peter on the other. When did that really begin? And when did you start seeing that those were the two who were, you know, were the two camps divided? And, you know, what was your face? So it's two questions. What was your first impression of Ace, and when did that bond start between Peter and Ace that you started to notice, and what specifically did you start noticing?
Well, my first impression of Ace was, you know, he was a really, really nice guy. I mean, you know, very sweet, very, you know, fun to be with, always laughing. And you know, he liked to party. That, you know, that was his thing. As far as them being Ace and Peter being a pair and Gene and Paul being a pair, that really wasn't the case at the very beginning. At the very beginning, I know, you know, they at one point they had to share rooms, like they had two people in a room, two guys in a room, that, you know, because they couldn't afford four hotel rooms, so they have two hotel rooms. And I know at that time Peter wanted to be with Paul. He didn't, you know, he didn't want to be with Ace in the room, and he didn't want to be with Gene in the room. Peter was a sort of a neat freak, and you know, he just he said Ace was too messy with all his guitars, you know, wires and guitar straps and everything all over the place, and Gene was just, you know,
I
don't know.
Too messy with
all of
his women.
Yeah, Gene with all of his women, right. But at one point, I mean, it wasn't like Gene. It wasn't Peter and Ace as a pair, you know. That eventually happened years later. But because we used to, you know, I've never gone on a vacation with Ace, but I have gone on a vacation with Paul. You know, Peter, Paul, and I guess whatever girlfriend he had at the time. But and then we also lived near each other, whereas, you know, Paul lived in Manhattan on the east side, and so did we. We only lived about 20 blocks from each other, whereas Ace lived up in the Bronx or Westchester at certain times. So we never really did see him that often. Gene was the one that was odd. You know, we hardly ever saw, you know, like as far as going out, like we'd go to clubs and it would always be Peter and Paul. It wasn't Peter and Ace. And so basically, you know, it eventually turned out to be Peter and Ace because of the drugs and the alcohol and stuff. But it evolved into that. And also because of the, you know, basically Gene and Paul, you know, they're real businessmen, whereas Peter and Ace could care less. I don't really know the business part of KISS because I wasn't allowed to be with, you know, in their business meetings. So that's basically it. But I do know that Peter and Ace have a different type of musicianship. You know, they're definitely, I guess, you know, a little more old school, you know. I'm just assuming, I'm not a musician myself, but, you know, they kind of, how could I say this? I don't know, maybe they were the two that were, I don't know. I can't really.
You're actually going right into my next question. Now, Peter talks about his jazz influence and stuff. Now, you've known Peter since, what, 1966? Just
yeah.
As a hardcore collector and fan that I am. Matter of fact, Lydia, I did a bunch of damage in Jacques' auction that from you. So stuff. But as a hardcore collector, there's one thing that eludes me that I've always looked for. Was Peter ever in like a jazz combo, or did he ever play that kind of music? I'm talking about playing, not being a fan. I know that he did, the bar mitzvahs and all that other kind of stuff, and, you know, played with the doo-wop stuff. But was he ever, did he ever play jazz in an actual band? And if so, is there any recordings?
No, as far as I know, he never did. I mean, okay. I met him, and supposedly he said that was his first band. So I met him when he was in the Barracudas. He was 20 years old. I guess before that he wasn't in a band. He was just playing. I mean, you know, he was best friends with Jerry Nolan, who was the drummer of the New York Dolls. And they played together. And they, as far as I know, he never played jazz. The only thing is he liked it because it was, basically, that's probably what his family had played at home, you know. I mean, I know they liked Ella Fitzgerald. I know his mother liked her. And, you know, the father must have liked the jazz. And, you know, I mean, Peter did like Gene Krupa. That was his favorite. But as far as I know, he never was in a jazz band.
It's funny because I love, you know, I'm a big Louis Prima fan. I got tons of his stuff. I love all that sort of stuff. But like I said, Peter talks about it, and I've heard him talk so many times about a jazz influence, but never heard him play that. So you answered a question I've always wanted to know the answer to. So yeah. As far as you know, he was never in a jazz combo. He never played jazz music.
No. Nope.
In I know it was mentioned in Paul's book, and I can't recall if it was mentioned in Peter's book, but there was talk of how Peter would quit the band. He'd get mad and he'd be in the Chinese restaurant and quit the band, and then they'd smooth things out and he's back. Do you recall times where he'd come home to you and he'd just be like, you know, these guys piss me off. What's going on? I've had it, you know. And he's acknowledged. I mean, that's sort of his temperament is like that. But do you recall that type of stuff going on?
I'm trying to think. You know, the thing is, I don't think, you know, for what I remember, you know, it was all kind of fun and games. I mean, that thing with the Chinese restaurant, I was there. That wasn't... you know, that wasn't fun and games, but that was probably one of the few times I think that they had an argument, and that Peter actually, you know, threatened to leave the band or left the band, and supposedly I talked him back into it. I mean, I did, but you know, Gene and Paul didn't. You know, they weren't around for that. They just, you know, I mean, I guess Peter must have told them, you know, Lydia wanted me to go back to the band, but that was one of the big fights. But I don't really remember. I mean, if anything, it was, you know, little, they used to just dig each other back and forth, you know, like, I know, I mean, one time I mean, it's in my book, you know, Peter came home once and I think it was, he was mad at one of the record producers, but it wasn't Gene or Paul, but one of the record producers was ribbing him and saying that I was flirting with Paul and that I had a crush on Paul, and he came home and took it out on me and beat me up.
Oh,
you know, yeah, but you know, I mean, I had a busted lip. He wanted it, you know, he was like, he was drunk. That was basically the thing, and they would, you know, they. He's very vulnerable, you know, like anything they would tell him, you know, he would take to heart. And, you know, I wound up getting the brunt of that. So I'm still pissed off at Kenny Kerner and Richie Wise.
Hey, Lydia, this is just something that's a current thing. Have you been watching that HBO vinyl thing? Because that's right. You know, New York.
You know, the funniest thing is I haven't been watching it because I don't have HBO. But I was at a friend's house the other night. I was actually I was actually at Bob Gruen's apartment, and he had it on. I was working with him on something, and I could hear it in the background. And everybody keeps saying it's not that good. You know, it's not, you know, I know it talks about Alice Cooper was on, and, you know, it talks about the dogs a lot. And I think I heard them mention Neil Bogard.
Yep.
And, but I just don't know what Mick Jagger would know about the New York scene at that time.
Well, you know, I'm enjoying it. I mean, you have to take it with a grain of salt, of course. But it's actually been very fun to watch as a TV show. It's just I thought maybe you'd be.
You know what it is. You're watching it as the person that wasn't there when
correct.
When
I'm
you
watching
watch
it as entertainment.
Yeah. Right. See, Bob was there.
Correct.
And he's going. It's so bad. He says it's so, you know, like it's not accurate. And that's what upsets the people that were around in those days. You know, the fact that it's not that accurate. I don't know, Martin Scorsese, I know he was famous then. I mean, I think he did Taxi Driver at that point.
Ending
but,
Streets.
Huh?
and Mean Streets. I think that was his first.
Mean Streets, that's the one. Yeah, yeah. That's right. Yeah.
Well, it's funny because I think that's the problem is that what's keeping some maybe big music fans, because I'm a 70s guy music wise. And I've read a ton of stuff about that era, and that's the first thing I said to myself is, well, this isn't accurate, but it's enjoyable, and that seems to be the problem I'm getting from people who are like going, oh, well, it's not accurate. Well, they never said it was, you know what I mean? But I'm just saying, just having a, you know, just overlooking the New York scene and how the record companies were, you know, kind of running back then. It was pretty fascinating stuff. I was just curious if you were watching it. That's all. Just because I knew that was your scene. I mean, that was right. That's ground zero.
Well, from what I could hear, I wasn't watching it because I was busy. But from what I could hear, it sounds, you know, like it's funny because there's a lot of cursing. There's a, you know, a lot of the record labels were pretty much, what, like cigar smoking old men that didn't really know that much about the business, you know, but they, you know, they didn't know much about music. They just record them. Yeah. Give them a deal, whatever, you know, but, I wish I was watching it, but I'll eventually see it. I'm sure it'll be out on DVD someday.
Are you working on a KISS book with Bob?
No, I'm actually I actually do Bob's bookkeeping. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh, nice.
Yeah,
that's cool.
Finishing up his taxes.
Yeah, we had him on about a couple months ago.
I actually got that.
Yeah,
I organized
that's right.
That.
Yep.
That's right. I completely forgot. Sorry, it's just 1 week goes into the next.
Yeah.
So, how was it for you then when things were starting to take off? Was that how long did it take from the time that like Alive went gold, you lost your job and that type of thing, to the point where you guys started to be able to get into a nicer apartment or a brownstone or whatever it was that you did? Is that when you started to feel like, wow, this is really happening? Were you questioning it up until that point? Or did you always feel like, even from the beginning, this is something I think that is so incredibly unique that I think that it's going to go somewhere?
Well, I really always had faith in KISS. You know, I always felt that they were doing great. You know, I never knew that the record company was, you know, considering dropping them. But when Alive went gold, I got a phone call from, KISS was on the road, and I got a phone call from Paul Stanley's girlfriend. She was in New York. And she told me, you know, she goes, don't tell Peter I told you, but Alive went gold today, and let him tell you. So I did. And right after that, I was told to go look for a place in Manhattan because we were thinking, we lived in Brooklyn, and it was a two family house, and one of the apartments was available that we could, it would have been a bigger apartment for us. And we were considering it, and Bill O'Coin said, no, he says, if you're going to move, you're going to move into the city. Living in Brooklyn, it's too far. It's, you know, that drive is going to kill Peter eventually, you know, if he has to be in the studio. So they told us to go look for a place in the city. And of course, you know, that job was left to me because Peter was on the road. I wasn't working at the time. So that was my job. Believe it or not, by the, that was November 7th that Alive went gold, and we were living in Manhattan by the end of the month.
Wow. So that was fast. So that must have felt really good. Like, wow.
Oh, it did. That's when we really felt like, well, we went from paying $210 a month rent to $600. So,
which is a huge leap back then.
Back then it was a big leap, yeah. And we moved into a newly renovated brownstone. I mean, it was actually, they were still renovating it. We moved in, and they had finished the top floor. We took the top floor. They were still working on the middle floor. And it felt like, you know, that's when I really felt. I remember I was walking across the street one day, and I just was stopped at a light, and I just said, I really felt like I had won the lottery.
That's great.
The big one.
Yeah. Well, were you able at that time frame then, once you moved to that brownstone, were you able to keep, or Peter, was he able to keep his anonymity for the most part? Because like it seems like nowadays, if you were famous, it's like with the internet and all of the searchable data, I think it'd be almost impossible to live a life without people constantly at your door.
Yeah, actually. We used to have limos come and pick us up all the time, and nobody knew. I don't even think the owner of the building knew who Peter was until once, believe it or not, we were at the Hermitage, which is out in California. It's a very high-class hotel, and I remember going into the restaurant and seeing the owner of the building sitting there having dinner with somebody, or lunch. It was lunch with somebody. And that's when I think he finally, found out who we were, who Peter was, actually. But, no, we were able to do a lot of things without, being noticed. That was in 75. We moved to Greenwich, Connecticut in 77, and we still weren't, they still had their, their makeup was still working for them. People didn't know, except the thing that they knew that somebody from KISS had moved into the neighborhood. But they didn't know what he looked like. They didn't know where he lived. And, the real estate brokers sometimes, they give things away. But I know we were going one day, we had a Mercedes and we had a station wagon. So we said, let's go to town. Town was about 20 minutes away from us. We were living in like the what they call the back country of Greenwich, which is, like we had 6 acres of land. And, so we went into town and we decided, we're hungry, but they didn't have a lot of fast food places, and we didn't want to sit down for a dinner. We didn't know what restaurants were good or not yet. So we just said, let's go to Wendy's. So we went to Wendy's and we were sitting there and we're eating chili, and Peter goes to me, they know who I am. And I said, what? And he has his back towards the people behind the counter. I'm facing the counter, right? And he goes, they know who I am. And I said, what are you talking about? They don't know who you are. And he says, trust me, they know who I am. So I said, just eat your food and let's get out of here then. So he ate his food, and as we were walking out, somebody yells out, Peter. And he turns around, which is a normal reaction. You're not prepared, because we had forgotten about that conversation that they know who I am. And we're talking about something else, and we turn around, and they started screaming, like, we told you it was him. We told you it was him. We dashed out.
That's great. And these are the kind of stories I love hearing about, because it gives it gives me, as a fan's perspective, a little insight into what it must have been like for you during that time frame, because I would think that in a smaller community, that word travels. Like I'm in Minneapolis, and I remember when Prince bought his first house out in Chanhassen, which is on the west side of the cities. Man, everyone seemed to know where it was, and they were constantly driving by and watching and this and that. And that was in, I don't know, probably 83, 84. So nowadays, I couldn't even imagine what it would be like to try to have any amount of privacy.
Yeah, well, luckily we had a driveway that was a quarter of a mile long. So people from the road couldn't really see the house. We did have eventually, one or two people drive down. And I remember Eddie Belandez was living with us at one point when we first moved in, and he was helping us, tanks, speakers, electrical stuff. He was really, 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 very handy. And we, he helped us a lot. And we must have been out, and somebody rang the doorbell, and Eddie answered it, and they said, can we talk to Peter? And he goes, I am Peter. And the look on their faces were like, oh, we thought the star lived here. He made believe he was Peter. But we did, you know, I mean, I've driven down my driveway and I ran into a girl in her car crying, coming the opposite way. I'm coming home, she's leaving, and I'm going, what's the matter? And she says, I tried to get Peter's autograph and he wouldn't give it to me. He slammed the door in my face. And I said, give me your name and address. And I made sure that he sent her a photo, an autograph photo.
Oh, that's nice.
So, he wanted his privacy, you know, but, you know, there were times we'd wake up and we'd see once we woke up and there was a photographer sitting on some rocks, you know, kind of just like away from the house, but, you know, with the big long lens and looking right into the, you know, into the kitchen, which is, you know, the probably the room that's easiest to see in because it had a lot of windows. But, you know, actually, now that I think of it, that house had a lot of windows. You know, we didn't have too much trouble with the fans because of the fact that we were so in the country.
And most of them seem really nice. I mean, I'm assuming that pretty much almost all of your interactions have been good, like at the conventions and just meeting people in general.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, the fans are great. You know, I don't think I've ever met a fan that I don't like. You know, they've always been really nice. You know, that's why I do conventions, because, you know, I feel comfortable.
That's great.
So Lydia,
you were always one of the highlights of the conventions, Lydia. Many times. The one that really stood out for me was an early one in Toronto, where Ace was the special guest. I talked to you quite a bit there when I was with my wife there, and I remember there was a little girl there dressed as Peter, and she looked fantastic. I ended up taking some pictures of her, and you really interacted with her. And I remember going, you know, how cool is that? Here's Peter's ex-wife all these years later talking KISS to this little kid, and she was like so into it, and you were so nice to her. And that, just a tip of the hat to you, just as a fan. That's one of those memories that still stands out all these years later, just how cool you've always been to the fans. And
there's another little girl in I believe it was Atlanta that was another little Peter, and I hung out with her too, and she sang Best to me, and I actually still keep in touch with her to this day, and that I'm talking 10 years ago.
Wow,
that's cool.
Yeah.
So Lydia, the album goes gold, and you know, success starts to creep in. What changes do you start seeing happening within the band?
Not much, because basically, you know, it's hard to kind of count, you know, how much you're worth, you know, that type of thing. Basically, I know we moved into the city and there was a time where I said to my girlfriend, I says, you know, I went to the store and I saw the shower curtain and it was $50 and I didn't want to spend $50 on a shower curtain. She goes, what are you, out of your mind? She says, get that shower curtain. And, you know, you don't realize that how much, you know, you're actually worth. And I didn't see much of a change yet. You know, I saw the changes basically when we moved to Connecticut, when we bought homes. You know, like, because Ace and Jeanette still, you know, they still rented an apartment in Westchester, and Gene and Paul still had rentals, and, you know, and nobody was really, like, going crazy with the money. I think they were also way too busy to change too much. You know, they still had a pretty hectic schedule. They hardly had time off. You know, they would do two albums a year, and you know, plus with all the photo sessions in between and the touring, and, you know, it was a pretty hectic schedule. And I think they all kind of stayed the way they had been. You know, Paul Stanley was always a sweetheart. You know, very, you know, easy to talk to. And Gene was the one you would talk to about, you know, finances and stuff like that. But I didn't see much of a change until, you know, like I said, when I think it was the Land of Hype and Glory.
Mm-hmm.
And they said something like they're all under 30 and they're all millionaires. That was pretty heavy. That, you know, we all, I think we were in the hotel room when we watched that, and everybody started screaming. And I think that was right after that is when we went, we started, you know, we meet. Peter was the first to start it. We wanted to move out of this, out of the city. Or they told us we should move out of the city because it, it moved to Connecticut because of the tax advantages in Connecticut. So we, you know, we went and we bought, in one day, we found a house, a sheepdog, and a Mercedes. All in one day.
Wow.
Are you there?
No, yeah, we're here.
Yeah, we're just listening because we, that's amazing. That must have been just like, and I suppose too, you know, like everybody else, you grow up in a family and you watch your money and you're conservative, like with the shower curtain thing. And it's like, then all of a sudden you've got all this money. I mean, that's just so, that's so mind blowing to me that they weren't even really aware of it till they saw it on TV.
Yeah. But you want to know why? Because they had business managers and all the money didn't, we didn't see the money. What we saw was a check once a week. And that check at the very beginning was $100. After they started getting a little bit more famous, became $200. By the time I got divorced from Peter, it was only $300 a week that we saw, but all of our bills were paid for. So we didn't even see our bills. You know, the mortgage went straight to the business managers, which were Glickman and Marks. And at one time, our rent went straight. You know, the electric bill went straight there. All of our credit cards went straight there. So we spent whatever we wanted, but we didn't actually see the money. They would have business meetings, and that's when they would discuss the value of what they had. But I know when I saw one of the TV shows that I was already divorced by then, that they said they made $117 million in merchant, no, $117 million a year. That was one of the shows. I forgot what show it was.
That was 2020, I think.
Sounds right.
Yeah, I mean that just kind of that rings a bell for me.
Yeah, it was sometime around the. In October of 79, and I remember, you know, just seeing, I saw a little cut, a little bit of it, you know, a little clip just recently on Facebook. But I don't know, they really didn't, as far as I know, they didn't change much until the solo albums. Well, maybe right before the solo albums.
You know, that's a time I actually want to touch on. Two things, Lydia. She talked about things changing. And there's a bunch of photos, because I'm here in Detroit, that you guys, you know, in early January of 76, you did the three nights at Kobo. And there's a bunch of pictures there. And I think that's when they got the key to the city. That had to, or maybe the key to the city was 77. I don't remember. But, I mean, that had to be a big change all of a sudden. You know, of course, this is after Cadillac, but... You know, here's these rock and roll guys that, you know, all demonic and, you know, literally a year and a half, 2 years later, are talking, they're giving them the keys to the city. That had to have been kind of peculiar.
The key to the city of Detroit or New York?
The one from Detroit.
Detroit. Oh, you know what it is? They were getting so much in those days. Like, you know, this album went gold, this album went platinum, this album went double platinum. You know, it was kind of hard to keep up. And you know, I don't really know what the, you know, the key to the city, what does that get you? I don't think it gets, that was my question. And I don't think it gets you much. You know, I mean, it was another event that they had a...
It'll get you $500 when you sell it to Mark Cicchini years later.
There you go. Had you only known that Mark was going to be around, you could have stockpiled.
The other thing I want to talk about is...
I never even saw the Key to the City.
Oh. The other thing I want to talk about goes back to our guest. Go ahead. Because this is like really garbled. I don't know what, you know, everybody's froze here. So hopefully you guys are hearing this. We had Alan on last week or 2 weeks ago about the Japanese tour.
We
a couple weeks ago we had an author that did a book on, you know, KISS in Japan, and there's a ton of pictures of you and Jeanette, you know, and the whole KISS crew going through Japan from 77. What was your, that had to be kind of overwhelming for a New York girl to land there, and just what was that like for you? That had to be, because that's about as close to Beatlemania as ever.
Yeah. Basically, that was really, really, really exciting. I mean, that happened to be, you know, 1977 was the year. I mean, first I did the People's Choice Award, and then we went to Japan. I mean, that's also the year we bought the house and the car and the dog, and, you know. But when we went to Japan, I was on the plane, and, you know, just the fact that we had the whole first class was unbelievable. I mean, I remember we were in the airport, and I was so overwhelmed that, you know, I mean, I was excited, and I mean, I never even thought I'd ever see Japan. And I said, let me thank the guys, and, you know, because we had time to kill, we were sitting there waiting, you know. So I said, let me thank the guys for making it possible for me to go to Japan. And I walked up to Gene first, and I said, Gene, you know, I just want to thank you for making it possible for me to go to Japan. He says, don't thank me. He says, Beth made it possible for all of us to go to Japan.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So that's, it was great. You know, I took pictures of the fans, from the plane. You know, they were waiting on like a balcony area. And, unfortunately, Jeanette and I and Bill Coyne, we didn't wait for KISS to actually leave the airport because of the fact that they wear makeup. Now, this is a time where it worked against them. They put the makeup on the plane, and they were leaving the airport, and the paparazzi are out there taking pictures, and you know, the fans and are there, but we, you know, it was mostly camera people that was, you know, that was when they were walking down like the corridors of the airport, and but when they got to customs, they had to take the makeup off, and then they had to reapply it when they came actually out of the airport. So Jeanette and I and Sean Delaney and Bill Coyne were outside, and we said, you know, we're not going to wait for them to do all this, you know, let the security take care of them. You know, they had their security people, Big John and, you know, Rick Stewart. And so we went to the hotel. So we never really saw the actual hysteria. But we kind of felt it, you know, when we were in Japan. You know, you could see it in the venues, and I know there were fans always outside the hotel, always, like, you know, looking up at the windows, trying to figure out which window was who. And you know, luckily we stayed in a hotel that had a garage in the basement, and we would go straight to the basement, get into the limos, and they would drive right out. And, you know, the fans wouldn't have access to the guys.
Well, and that's the only way to do it, you know, really, I'm sure, because it was pandemonium. And in fact, I want to touch on something before I forget.
Okay.
Is it true that you might possibly have the only real footage of the four of them during the height of their popularity, not in makeup, from some of the stuff you filmed?
Yeah.
Okay, so it exists. There you go, people. That's another one to chew on for a while.
But I have to explain something. Okay.
Yes.
that was in March when we went to Japan, or April, it was somewhere in the spring. Bill O'Coin had just given us a camera. He gave all of us a Super 8 with sound. And that's what I brought, you know, with me to take pictures. And I really didn't know how to use the camera. So some of them came out and some of them didn't. Some of them did. Yep. Some of them have sound. Some of them don't. They have been transferred. So they're, you know,
they're safe.
There is some video that I have. I'm not, I don't know what I'm waiting for to put it out, but it will come out.
It will come out. I've known about that for a while. I've been like, when is this going to get out?
Of course you have, Mark.
It is. It's not great. It's not great footage, so that's why.
It's on the plane, right?
Yeah, it's on the plane. Yeah,
yeah. That, yeah, like I said, it's because I'm super
put their makeup on.
What's that?
It was before they put their makeup on.
Yeah, I've
but you have to understand, from our perspective, Lydia, as young teenagers and kids being so interested in this band, I mean, for Christ's sakes, I'm 50 years old, and here I am sitting on a talk show or a podcast talking with one of the original members' wives, and I'm 50 years old. So it's like, you know, this stuff is still interesting to us. It really, truly is. And I get people all the time going, well, how can you guys talk about it every week? And I'm like, you'd be amazed at how many subjects there are. So for me, that's the kind of stuff that's always exciting, even if the footage isn't great. Hopefully someday it will see the light of day so people can see it.
Yeah, yeah, it will.
You know, and it's not like you're going to burn it like some people have threatened to do with other video footage. You know, might not know about that, but our friend Kurt had something up for sale, and he had threatened to burn it if he couldn't sell it, which totally blew up his face. Oh yeah, that's Kurt. You know, he's a drama guy.
Oh,
so it's all good.
Yeah. Well, actually, he's the one that talked me into putting it on. You know, getting it transferred.
Yeah, and he's right. That's smart. You know, it's good to do because that way it's preserved.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah, so yeah, we kind of joke around at his expense sometimes.
Yeah. I know you had him on. I actually did see that.
Yes. Yes, we did.
So Lydia, we talked a bit earlier about, you know, the dynamics of the band of the Ace Peter versus Gene and Paul. After that success happened, is that when you saw that shift?
I'm not sure. I think it was like, I think it's, I started seeing a little bit of resentment maybe around, I know the Love Gun, is Love Gun the one that has a Hard Luck Woman on it?
No, that's Rock and Roll Over.
Oh, Rock and Roll Over. Okay, so then it's Rock and Roll Over that I know, I was living in the city at the time, and I think was that Rock and Roll Over? Was I think that was done up in Eddie Kramer did that?
Yes, correct. That's the one that was
done at the theater.
Yes,
in Nyack or something.
Correct. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Newburgh. No. Yep. Wait. Where was it done?
I think you had it the first time. Nyack, is it? Is that
Nyack,
right?
Yeah. Newburgh was the airplane hangar. That they rehearsed in. I mean, I know at that point, you know what it is, Peter was living in the city, he wanted a party, and so, you know, Ace, I think Ace had an apartment, I'm not sure, but, you know, they weren't as focused as Gene and Paul were, and I know that Paul wrote the song Hard Luck Woman, and he wanted to sing it. And Eddie Kramer made Peter sing it, and which is not what you normally, whoever writes the song gets to sing it. And I think there was a little resentment there that, you know, it came out so good, you know. But I still didn't see, you know, much until I think when, you know, right before the solo albums, it's, you know, I didn't even know that they were like, you know, I mean, I read, sometimes Bill O'Coin would, you know, do an interview, and I would read that, you know, he said that they were, you know, kind of going their own separate ways, so they decided to do the solo albums. I really wasn't, you know, aware of that. But, you know, right, I know during the solo albums, well, that's, you know, that's also the time of my, Peter and I, not, you know, and he just, you know, we, out of nowhere, we were getting divorced. I didn't even know that, you know, there was anything wrong. I mean, we were planning on having kids, and all of a sudden, he just turned to, you know, he turned to be a totally different person than I knew. And
do you think some of that's fame?
Oh, it was fame, and it was drugs, and, you know, I mean, he had met someone. You know, I mean, it all got to him at one point, you know, like I was always like, you know, the wife that would like, you know, take care of him, like, you know, like, come on, the fans want an autograph, give him an autograph, or, you know, like, or come on, you did enough drugs, stop, you know, like, let's go to sleep. Like, I was always like, you know, the person that was trying to keep him normal, but, you know, there were a lot of times that I wasn't around, you know. I mean, I couldn't really take care of him as much as I wanted to. And, you know, I'm sure the same thing with Ace and Jeanette. So, you know, they kind of went their, you know, crazy way, and Gene and Paul resented it. You know, they resented the fact that they were working all the time and Peter and Ace were partying all the time.
Well, I suppose, you know, and it's like anything else. You've got all these different personalities, and then you mix fame into it and all of that, and it's probably really hard to take and kind of stay normal. I mean, look at how many people that are in the industry or in film or whatever, and they end up in the same situation. It almost seems like you have to move away from it to be able to stay grounded.
I know that... you know, Peter and Ace, you know, the Peter thing was, oh, I paid my dues. I deserve this, blah, blah, blah. You know, that was part of his attitude. Ace, you know, he was just on another planet. That's all we could say about Ace. I mean, Ace is not the same anymore. When I see Ace, I see a different person. You know, I see him a lot. Not a lot, but whenever he plays in the New York area. He's just so much calmer. He's just, you know, he's not that happy-go-lucky, joke-telling personality that he used to be.
Is that good?
He's a lot more serious.
Which do you like? Which do you prefer, Lydia?
The in between.
A little of both.
I don't like when he's, you know, totally out of it. You know, some of the stories that I've heard, you know, read in his book, you know, and I'm read in his book, read in Peter's book, read, you know from the, just from interviews, you know, some of the stories about him, almost, you know, passing out and, you know, pulling a Whitney Houston, you know.
Yeah. Well, and speaking of those books, when you read different books like that, do you ever have any aha moments like, oh, okay, so now that explains why that was going on at the time? I mean, do those books, when you're reading about them, even though they're written by someone else and you're involved at the same time, it's maybe not your recollection of something, do you ever feel that way?
Well, basically... Ace's book, I knew a lot of the stories, so I kind of knew a lot, so there wasn't much to, you know, to say that about. But as far as Peter's, I actually read Peter's book with a highlighter in my hand, and I highlighted everything that was wrong.
So was the whole book yellow?
What?
Was the whole book yellow at the end?
Well, actually, I had a pink highlighter, so it's pretty pink.
That's funny. Lydia, what was the most glaring thing that was wrong?
Well, he He says at the beginning of his book, and I don't know if a lot of people see this, but he said, I changed the names to protect, you know, sort of, he doesn't say it in these words, but I changed the names of some of the people to protect the innocent or something, you know, that saying, the names right. have been changed to protect the innocent. You know, like he'll tell a story and he'll say it was Sean Delaney when it was actually Bill O'Coin. And you know what it is? Most of the people that he talks bad about aren't alive anymore. So they can't even defend themselves. You know, like he tells stories about Sean, about Bill, about Eddie Melendez, you know, people that, you know, Stan Penridge, you know, that they can't really defend themselves. But Peter, you know, Peter's basically a very, he's an exaggerator. And, so, you know, that was one of the things that I noticed a lot in his book. I don't know, you know, the stories that he tells after I wasn't with him, I don't know, you know, whether they were true or not. You know, that's, that was his life, you know, when he talks about going into a rehab and stuff like that. I really don't know about that. And also the breakup of, you know, when he left KISS, I really don't know about that either, because I always thought he left KISS, and then I hear years later that KISS left him. That it was, you know, it was a mutual thing.
Lydia, when that happened, did you reach out to Peter and just say, hey, how you doing? Are you okay?
No, because it was pretty much after we got divorced. It was pretty close to when we got divorced. Like, we got divorced in September of 79, and he was out of KISS by within 6 months. So he had Deborah at the time. I couldn't reach out to him. The only time I reached out to Peter and I never got, you know, I mean, I left a message, but I never got a response, was when John Lennon was killed. You know, that was the end of 80, so that was about a year after we were divorced, and I knew how much he loved John, so, but I never got a response. I mean, I got response, you know, like Peter and I don't talk to each other on a regular basis, but when we see each other, we'll talk, and, you know, I mean, the last time I actually spoke to Peter was at Bill O'Coin's memorial, so that was almost, well, we're going on 6 years now, 5.5 years. I did speak to, through an email, I did speak to Gigi, but that, you know, that was actually right around the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame time. They had invited me, actually, to go with them, and I didn't, only because I had just finished reading his book, and I wasn't too happy.
That's funny.
You need, you know what? Your next book needs to be the highlighted version of Peter's book.
Oh, the yes. funniest thing is I actually put out my second printing of my book. I said I should have waited until Peter's book came out, and then I should have put my book out with all the corrections in it. With all the corrections of Peter's book.
Hey, speaking of, you talked about exaggeration. There's one thing in KISS lore where Paul really says that, you know, the song Beth was, Peter had very little to do with. What is your recollection of Peter's contribution to the song Beth? Which obviously okay. we know was Beck first.
Yeah, the thing is, Gene and Paul are always saying that because Peter's the first one to throw it into their faces that he wrote the biggest song in KISS. You know, Peter likes to, you know, brag about that. Like, you know, if they say something about Peter, I'll say, yeah, but just remember, I'm the one that wrote Beth. You know, anyway, Peter did write Beth, okay? Him and Paul, and him and Stan Penridge, there's a picture of Stan's building. It was a little studio apartment on Lafayette Street in the Village that they used to go and play. And this was after Chelsea. I think it was probably around the time, maybe the very beginning of Lips or maybe the end of Chelsea. I'm not sure, but I know it was about, the song was about Rebecca. Now that was Michael Brand's wife. There's a picture in my book of both of them. Her name was Rebecca, and everybody called her Beck. So it was Becky. And they were just newly married, like Peter and I were at the time. And but she would always constantly call the studio where I didn't. You know, Peter says, they lived in Manhattan. And, you know, I mean, we lived in Brooklyn at the time. So it was like a lot longer for Peter to get home than for Mike. But yet she'd always call the studio. When are you coming home? When are you coming home? When is this going to end? When are you going to be finished? You know, so she was kind of annoying, but I never knew her that way. I knew her. She was a teacher. And she was a great cook, and that's the way I knew her as a, you know, and as a good friend. And I never knew she was annoying to the guys. So they, you know, Stan Penridge and Peter wrote this song. I remember once sitting in a Chinese restaurant in Chinatown with my two best friends, my girlfriend Brenda and her husband, waiting for Peter to come, you know, to have dinner. And he was late. He was, you know, pretty, about, you know, maybe about an hour late. And, you know, we said, what took you so long? Because there were no cell phones in those days. And, you know, we're like, what happened? You know, and he said, well, I was at Stan Penridge's and I had to finish this song. And we wrote this great song, and it's called Beck. And I said, okay, fine. You know, when I go home, I'll listen to it, because he had it on a little cassette tape. And, you know, I listened to it, and it was nice. And I said, yeah, well, what are you going to do with it? And he says, I don't know. You know, so basically you can't give it to Chelsea maybe they were still in Chelsea. I'm not sure. I said, you can't give it to them because that's an insult, you know, insulting his wife. You know, so anyway, it just sat there did nothing for years. And then finally, I know we were living in Manhattan at the time, and yeah, because it was put on Destroyer. We had just moved to the city. I remember sitting in a limo, and, well, Peter had, you know, wanted a song. He says, you know, I never get any songs on the albums, you know. He was like, you know, the Ringo of Kiss. And Ace hardly got any songs either. So it was basically like the Ringo and the George Harrison. And Gene and Paul were Lennon and McCartney. But, and that's the funniest thing is that's why Paul's name is Paul, because of Paul McCartney.
Really?
You know, his real name is Stanley Eisen, and I asked him, why'd you change your name to Paul? He goes, McCartney. Okay, so it came right out of his mouth. So, but anyway, back to Beck. And so, you know, Peter presented this song to them, and Gene and Paul didn't want it. You know, it's a ballad. We don't want that, you know. Yeah. And Bill Lacoin pushed it, and they said, you know, we'll put it, you know, on the back of a, we'll put it on the album, and we'll put it on the back of a single. So that's what they did, and they, you know, I was busy. I had just moved into Manhattan, so I was busy decorating and shopping, you know, for furniture, because we moved from, little one bedroom into a larger two bedroom. And, you know, so we needed furniture. We needed, you know, some nicer things. And I was out shopping. And so I didn't go to the studio that much, which I normally used to go all the time. Cause I loved, you know, watching, you know, hearing a voice without music and then hearing the music without the voice, you know? So anyway, They finally, you know, one day, you know, they said, we want you to come down to the studio. So I said, okay. So I went down, and they sat me on a chair, and they put headphones on me. Oh, well, wait, before I get to that, we were in a limo once, and Gene said, we can't call this song Beck because of Jeff Beck. Now, I'm not sure if Paul was in the limo, but I know Ace wasn't. So it was maybe Gene, Peter, maybe Paul and myself. And I said, well, why don't you call it Beth? You know, because Neil Bogart's wife's name was Beth. And, you know, I think at that point that, you know, they were actually maybe suing Casablanca for some unpaid royalties, I think. And so it was a little bit of a, you know, like a, well, why don't you name it Beth? And Neil Bogart. Oh, Beck was a twin, and Neil Bogart's wife was a twin. So I thought that, you know, the kind of the coincidence. So you know, they said, that sounds nice, you know. And so they called me into the studio. They sat me on the chair. They put headphones on me, and they said, you know, well, what do you think of the song? And, you know, as the tears are rolling down my face, I said it should have been called Lydia. And, you know, one of the lines I did write, in that, you know, I said it to Peter, and Peter brought it to, I didn't say put this in the song, but I said it in my own, you know, like I said, I was, you know, like, I paid the bills for 6.5 years, and then all of a sudden I wasn't paying the bills anymore, and I felt kind of empty. So I said, you know, I don't even feel like this place is, you know, this house is my home. I feel so empty, you know, and I put that in the song. And that's basically it. You know, they called it, I said, you know, they said, what do you think of it? And I said, it should have been called Lydia. And that was, you know, but I, you know, I did accept the People's Choice Award for it, even though a lot of people say, well, that song really wasn't written about you. And I'm going, but, you know, it was rewritten with me in mind.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you, Lydia, is at what point did the story become Peter wrote this song about his wife?
I don't know. I guess once it was rewritten. Because every time he'd come out and sing the song, he would actually stop. If I was there at the event, you know, I would always stand by the soundboard. And he would come over and he would bow to me. And then he would go and sit on the stool. Now, a lot of people didn't see him do that, but he did it every single show. And then when they won, you know, when they knew they were getting the People's Choice Award, because the People's Choice Award is one of the awards that you do know who's the winner, because it was only the third People's Choice Award, and it wasn't that famous. So people, you know, in order for people to show up, they told the people who won, because a lot of people send somebody, you know, oh, let's send, you know, like Leonardo DiCaprio sent his mother to pick up, you know, an award if he had no idea he was winning it. Whereas if you know you're going to win it, you know you're going to be there. Now, in Kiss's case, they couldn't be there because of the makeup. They already had bookings. They only found out a week, 10 days before the People's Choice Award, they found out that they had they had
10
won.
10 days? 10 days?
10 days before, yeah.
That seems crazy.
Yeah, we were sitting in Detroit, Michigan. I remember we were backstage. Me, Gene, and Peter were sitting at a table, and Bill O'Coin came over to us and said, you won. I got a letter from, I know he said somebody's name, and we said, we don't even know who that is. And he said, well, you know, KISS won the People's Choice Award, and, you know, it's going to be, you know, televised on February 10th, I think it was. And they said, well, you know, what do you want to do? Do you, you know? And they said, well, we can't sit in the audience with makeup on. We can't accept this, you know. And I was joking, and I just said, I'll accept the award. And there was silence, and Gene goes, okay. And I said, what? He goes, okay. Okay, I had to get a dress, hair, makeup, nails, and whatever else I needed to, you know, to do this, and I had to do it in 10 days. I literally lost 10 pounds in 10 days because I was a nervous wreck, and I was too busy running around. Look, you know, Jeanette helped me. We went, you know, she goes, I know a place where, you know, because I saw a dress that I wanted, and it was on Madison Avenue, but they didn't have it in black, and I didn't want it in, I think they had it in blue. And I don't even think they had it in white. But anyway, it turns out Farrah Fawcett was wearing that dress. She had it on in white. But I wanted something black, you know, to go with KISS. Because I had asked Sean Delaney, I said, Sean, should I dress rock and roll or should I dress classic? And he said, absolutely classic. Don't do the, like, I could have dressed like KISS, you know, like I could have put the, you know, the leather jumpsuit on and, you know, the studded belts and stuff like that. But he said, no, dress classy. So I went out and I got this. I found the dress, believe it or not, somewhere up with Jeanette in Jeanette's neighborhood, very similar in black. And then it turns out that me and Goldie Hawn were almost wearing the same dress. So it was a popular dress in those days.
Now, so going back to that particular situation, do you remember any interaction with people like someone like Goldie Hawn that knew who you were then at that point because of that? Or, you know, was there any that type of thing where people started to go, okay, well, this is Peter's wife? And
no,
you know,
actually, okay. Actually, it wasn't supposed to be known that Peter was married. I went up there and I said my speech, but I didn't say who I was. And the weirdest thing is, before I went up, you know, Goldie Hawn said, "Congratulations, Beth." You know, so I'm sitting next to Bill O'Coin. He goes, "Go ahead. This is, you know, they never tell you when to go up." He goes, you know, so he nudged me. He said, "Okay, go now." I mean, I'm a nervous wreck. You know, I never spoke in front of people before. And, you know, nobody introduced me. Because right as soon as I got up there, they started, you know, the tape they had made in Detroit, you know, where Peter thanks everybody and then they sing the song Beth. And or maybe they sing the song Beth first. And so I'm standing there while he's singing this song, but it's taped already. It's pre-taped. So I'm not seeing this. I'm just seeing the audience and I'm just hearing it. And then all of a sudden there was like I heard Peter say, thank you all. And then there was silence. So I figured this is my time to start my speech, I guess. And so nobody introduced me. And then Dick Van Dyke introduced me at the end when I had already gotten the award and walked off stage. He said, "Oh, by the way, that was the song for whom that was the best for whom the song was written. The wife of the drummer, Mrs. Peter Criss." He never even said Lydia. So At that time, it was supposed to be sort of like, you know, John Lennon and Cynthia Lennon, that nobody knew Peter was married. Peter was the only one. Well, at that time, no, at the beginning, Peter was the only one married. By that point, Ace was just married, yeah.
Which is so silly because as a fan, I knew he was married. So that's just, that goes to show you how ineffective that was.
Yeah,
you know?
I know it was really, I mean, I don't think Bill O'Coin cared, but for some reason, Alan Miller, he was, I don't know what position he held at O'Coin Management, but he didn't want the fans to know that I was married. And I know it was a common thing. They really didn't want it publicized. If it was found out, you know, if somebody found out, they found out. But that's when it was actually,
Lydia,
you know.
How did that make you feel?
I didn't really. It didn't bother me. It didn't bother me because I would do anything to get, you know, so that they would. If that was going to make them successful, I'll go with it.
Okay.
You know, I didn't really
That's
care
a good
as long
attitude,
as I,
though.
I as long as I could travel when I wanted to. I used to go to all the good shows. You know, California every 6 months we'd go to California, you know, to L.A. And, you know, I went to Detroit, you know, I went to all the major, you know, shows, and, I got to travel and I, you know, I got to live a, you know, pretty good life.
Well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's from the outside looking in, it sure looked like it was fun.
It was fun.
Lydia, let me ask you, Sean Delaney, how important was he to KISS?
Oh, very important. I mean, he never gets the full credit he's due. He created all the choreography at the very beginning. They didn't have that. He's the one that created. You know, he's the one that had the idea for the fire. The blood. The exploding drumsticks, you know, the pickups that went on, you know, Ace used to have, you know, the pickups went on, he had like the smoke behind them. Also, Ace used to have these little things that he used to throw out into the audience, like, and they would, I guess, what do you call those? Paper, something paper.
Flash paper.
Flash paper, yeah. But that was all Sean Delaney's idea. And, you know, they also, I think Sean got them, you know, nicer costumes. they were dressing, you know, at one point just in jeans, you know, jeans and T-shirts. And then eventually, you know, they're wearing leather. You know, he brought them to this place called the Pleasure Chest down in the village. And they, you know, it was like an S&M store that had, like, you know, all these chokers and, you know, the studded wristbands and belts and stuff like that. And he found the seamstress that made all his clothes. The first it was a guy, and then when they went to that was when the guy made the leather stuff. That was Larry Legatsby. And then they went to Maria Contessa, who is she did all the spandex clothes. She was with them most of their career. So she you know, I mean, I'm still you know, in touch with Maria.
So you still have, yes, that's kind of neat too, that you made these lasting friendships through the band, that you're still in touch with a lot of these people to this day.
Yeah. I was, you know, in touch with Mick Campisi until he died. Bill Coyne, he slept at my apartment, and then got on a plane and was never the same after that. You know, he went straight to the hospital. Sean Delaney used to sleep here too, you know, when they were in the city. I just reconnected with somebody else. I mean, I was friends with Eddie Belandis for many, many years. I just saw John Hart, not recently, but I'm still a little bit in touch with him. I saw Fritz, which was the sound guy, and, you know, I mean, I did lose, you know, like, that's the thing. When I did get divorced, you do lose a lot of friends and family, you know, but then eventually they come back. It's like, you know, you find them, you know, here and there, and you hook up with them again.
Did you
know, because I hadn't seen Sean in years. And then all of a sudden he's working with Ace. So, you know, I mean, I hooked up with him again, you know, through Ace. And, Bill Coyne, I just ran into at one of Peter's shows. You know, I mean, when Peter was playing the Ritz back in the 90s, I hadn't seen Bill in years. And, I think it might have been almost 10 years I hadn't seen him. And, you know, I used to go to his apartment. And, you know, I used to go to Studio 54, and then I'd call it like 3 or 4 in the morning, and there'd be a party at Bill's.
Well, and I want to ask you, you know, cause since we touched on the TV show Vinyl earlier, I would like to know a little bit about, because as a kid growing up in Minneapolis, which has gotten considerably larger than it was when I was young, New York always seemed to me like such a magical place. And it wasn't just because that's where KISS was from. It just seemed like such a cool city to be a part of. And then to see all of these different biographies and read all these different things about what it was like to actually be there in the 70s, you know, knowing that, say, Studio 54 was such a hard club to get into, were you able to use some of what you had gotten out with the band to get into that type of thing? Was it easier to get through the door, or were you standing out in line like everybody else?
No, I didn't stand in line. It did get us into a lot of places, but with Studio 54, I really didn't use KISS as a because I was already divorced by the time I started hanging out at Studio 54. I mean, when Studio 54, before it was actually opened, Peter and I did go there. We were at Trax, and Trax was another club that everybody used to hang out at. It was in this on the Upper West Side, and believe it or not, we were living in the city at the time, that brownstone in the 30s, and we ran into Jimmy Page, and Peter invited him to our apartment, and I was, the first thought in my mind was, oh no, he's going to wreck my apartment. What am I going to do? You know, and it turned out that Peter Grant, his manager, wouldn't let him go. Jimmy had just gotten over an overdose, you know, situation. So he says, you're not going. How do you know that's Peter Criss? This is when it doesn't work in your favor with the makeup, because there was no makeup. And Peter Grant goes, how do you know that's Peter Criss? You don't know what Peter Criss looks like. Any guy could tell you that. You can't go to his apartment. And he goes, but he's got a limo outside. He says, so what? So you wouldn't let him go with us. Turns out they wind up going to Studio 54. We didn't even know it because it wasn't really officially opened. We went with Sean because Sean knew the owners. So we went with Sean, and we were walking around, and it was empty. And who's there but Led Zeppelin walking around in an empty club also. But as far as later on in years, like in the 80s, when I moved back to the city for, I rented my house out, and I moved back into the city, and I would go with a guy named John. No, Joe. His name was Joe. He was introduced to me by Bill Coyne. Now, he was going out with Queen Elizabeth's cousin, John Bowes Lyons. So he was, okay. Joe was gay. All right, and so was John Bowes Lyons. So they knew the owners of Studio 54. So every time I used to go to Studio 54, it was always with Joe. So we used to just, wave to the bouncer and walk in. Never had to pay. Never had to wait online.
So one of the things that was a big deal for me in high school was there was so many people who were big Led Zeppelin fans who felt that Led Zeppelin was just so much better than Kiss, and that they aren't even in the same ballpark musically, and on and on and on and on. And that was always frustrating as a fan. So it's interesting to hear these stories about people like Jimmy Page and the band in general who you ended up running into. Do you ever remember them talking about the band at all, or in your conversations? I'm always curious what the peers, like someone like that, would think of the whole thing with Kiss. Did they get it?
Well, I really never had that lengthy of a conversation with any of the guys. And I mean, I've taken pictures of Robert Plant, but I never really spoke to him. Gotcha. Jimmy's the one that I've talked to a few times. The time I spoke to him the most was at a girlfriend's birthday party in Florida. I was at my friend's house, and he was a guest, and I was talking to him, and he mentioned Ace. He said, how's Ace doing? He asked me, do you ever hear from the guys in Kiss, blah blah blah. So at that point, I mean, we're talking the 90s it was probably the 90s, yeah. So, at that point, by then, Kiss was pretty well known, and I don't think that they looked at them as stars back in the, in the day, in the 70s.
Right.
Because like you said, Zeppelin and The Who were that much better musicians, and their songs were more technical and the makeup, that's another time when the makeup hurt them.
Yeah, it seemed like for all it did to give them fame or help them with their career, it also had a negative impact as well in certain situations.
Yeah.
Lydia, did you see the band when they reunited in 96? Did you go to a show?
Yeah, I actually was at the Unplugged first. What happened was my friend John, who now works with Ace, he didn't at the time, worked for MTV, and he told me that that Kiss was doing this Unplugged thing, and so I asked Ace. I said, Ace, could you give me a ticket? Two tickets. I want to go see this, and he says, to be honest with you, you have to ask your friend John. He would be the one that could get the tickets, not me, because it's an MTV thing. So I said, okay. So I asked John. He gave me the tickets. So I was at it was Unplugged. It was in 1995, in August, I think. And then when they did finally reunite, I kind of knew it was going to happen. Jeanette had told me, but she said, don't say anything. And then, yes, I did go to see them. What happened was I went to see The Who. I went to see Quadrophenia at the Garden. And my boss, who was, female at the time, she owned the photo agency that I worked for. And I was with her. And she said, let's go across to this bar. You know, we're going to meet some of the guys that work for The Who, and we're going to have some drinks. So I said, okay. So we went across the street from the bar, and I didn't know any of the guys. So she knew the guys, so she's talking to them. I'm sitting by myself at the bar, and this older gentleman sits next to me, and he says to me, you know, he starts talking to me, and I told him, you know, he said, what are you doing here, blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, I just went, came from the garden. I just saw The Who, blah, blah, blah. And I said, you know, the funniest thing is my ex-husband's playing there next week, and I'm not even going to be going. And he goes, why not? And, so I told him, you know, well, I really haven't been in touch with him for many years, you know. And he says, well, I'm the vice president of the garden. He said, so if you want to go, here's my number, call me. So I called him, and he walked me right in with my boyfriend at the time, and he said, where do you want to sit? And I said, I want to sit up there, you know, and he said, okay. He went up, and he got two people out of their seats, and he says, come with me. The two people stood on the ground level, and we sat like it's actually like with the promoter's seats. They're like a little bit one level up. And that's when I saw them then, and then I called him again for Psycho Circus, and he got me in again.
So let me ask you, what did you think of KISS in 96 compared to KISS in 76?
You know, I kind of, let's see. I really didn't see much of a change. I think I heard that Peter wasn't playing. I think he was playing some sort of electrical drums or something like that. But, you know, the stage to me seemed a little bit barren compared to the way I remembered it. I remember it, you know, like there wasn't that much. It seemed like it was sized down. But then I did get to see them years later in Finland where they had the spider stage. Mm-hmm. And I was totally blown away because I was never allowed to actually see the band, you know, from a distance. I had to be on the stage or sitting in a seat. Peter never wanted me, you know, to be in the audience, and he never wanted me to be in the photographer's pit, because it was too dangerous. So when I got to see them in Finland, I was with Richie Scarlett, who's Ace's guitar player, and his wife.
Yep.
We did a convention together, and KISS was starting their tour. And we had tickets for the ground, and Richie Scarlett said, I'm not standing on the ground. I want, you know, so we had like a guide, a girl that was like, she took care of us in Finland, and she, you know, she went to all the people as they were coming in asking if they wanted to, you know, change three seats. For, you know, if they wanted to stand on the ground, we'll take their seats. Turns out their seats were right at the top of the venue. We were like almost at the highest point, which was actually the best show I think I've ever seen. I really loved it. We didn't stay for the whole show, but I really thought it was amazing. You know, that stage was just awesome.
So what do you think about Tommy and Eric portraying the characters? Because there's been a lot of arguments and disagreements amongst fans that it's sacrilege to do that, and you know, this, that, and the other, and some people are very, very upset, and other people don't care. What is your viewpoint?
Well, I really don't care, but I think what I like better is when they with Eric Carr, when he came up with his own
right
makeup. You know, it's funny when I see pictures and I see Tommy Thayer in the Ace's makeup, I know it's Tommy Thayer. But for some reason, when I see Eric Singer in Peter's makeup, sometimes I have to look three times to see. Is Peter or is it Eric? You know, like, what band is this? You know, is this an old picture or is this a new picture?
Let me check the tattoos to make sure who it is.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I mean,
they're really nice guys, both of them.
Yes.
And, I mean, Eric Singer is, you know, I mean, he's been around a long time. And they've both been with KISS longer than Peter and Ace.
Right.
Well, so Lydia, let me ask you, you know, before we wrap up here, I want to give you a chance to talk about your book a little bit. So you've got a book which the three of us have said is one of the top KISS books out there, that if you're a KISS fan, you need to get it. It's,
yeah, that's all there is to it. You have to have it.
Where do you get it? Where do fans get it from you?
Right now, the only place you can get it is my website, Amazon, or eBay. There is a store down in Myrtle Beach that sells it, and that's kind of it. I haven't really, you know, I don't have a distributor, so it's not in bookstores, and I really, bookstores don't like to deal with independent, you know, authors. They like to deal with, you know, a book company, a publisher, a real publisher, whereas I'm my own publisher. So, you know, I've been selling it that way most of the time. I mean, I do conventions. I do I'm doing something in June, in St. Louis. Yeah, St. Louis. And it's a... I forgot what the name of it. We're just right now talking, you know, doing the contracts and stuff. But it's a 3-day event. It's sort of like Chilla.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I mean, they've asked me to do Sweden a couple of times this year, and I turned them down only because I'm a little afraid to go to Europe with what's going on over there. So even though
well,
I know
it's reasonable.
Huh?
I said that's reasonable because you just don't know with everything that's going on right now.
Yeah, you don't. So I figured let me just, you know, stay home in the United States area. I would love to do something. I think I was going to do something. I might do something, as a matter of fact, maybe towards the summer in Vancouver. But that's, you know, that's to be seen, you know, see if it happens. But, you know, I do, you know, I think maybe this year it might be in April, a KISS convention in New Jersey. And that's about it. You know, I mean, I do have sales every now and then. I just had pretty big one in, it was for the anniversary of KISS's first show. Mm-hmm. At the Coventry, so the end of January, January 30th, I had a big sale, a one-day sale. I think we're going to be giving away something for free with my book, but that's to be seen. That's a little hint.
Let us know if and when that happens, and we'll make sure to post something.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah,
I
absolutely.
Will. Okay.
So then, is it what's your web address again?
LydiaCriss.com. www.LydiaCriss.com.
Okay, and everything's right there, and you can order an autographed copy, you can order an unsigned copy, and this is the second printing, correct?
Correct.
Okay, so there's more information than the first.
More information.
Well.
There's a little bit, very few corrections. You probably wouldn't even notice them. There's 16 more pages and 22 more photos.
Oh, perfect. So anyone that does not have this book, please go out there and get it. You will not be disappointed. The stories and the photos are amazing.
I mean, it's a heavy coffee table book. It weighs almost 5 pounds. It's almost 400 pages. I'd say probably about 1,500 photos. And I think I was told about 120,000 word text, something like that.
Okay. Well, and you know, if it wasn't for you taking all those pictures, there wouldn't be anything.
Mm-hmm. Really. I know. You know, it's funny. There was one of the concerts I was at when KISS, before they knew a coin, you know, this is in the early days, I'm standing there with a little Instamatic camera because that's all I had. And we didn't have money. You know, my girlfriend gave me this camera when I was 16. That was, you know, one of my presents. And it was a little Kodak Instamatic. And I'm standing there taking pictures. And this older gentleman standing next to me, and he says, you know what? Someday you're going to make a lot of money off those photos.
Who was that?
I don't know who it was. I don't know. It was a person. It was just somebody that was in the audience, but it was in a club. It was like practically empty. The club had hardly anybody in there. It might have even been a diplomat, for all I remember. You know, it was like that far back.
Wow.
Hey, yep. I got a question. With all the, you know, like you said, you know, you're a New York girl, and all of a sudden, you know, your husband rise to fame. A couple questions. Number one, during the KISS heyday, were you ever starstruck? Did you get to meet some people, like you said, Jimmy Page and those? Was there anybody that you ran into that you ever went, wow, you know, I'm able to talk to or see or meet?
During the KISS days, it was Mick Jagger.
Wow.
That was, we knew all of the characters on Saturday Night Live. So we were at one of their parties, and Belushi was like a personal friend of ours. He would come to, you know, our apartment and carry on like he was, you know, acting on the show. He came to our house in Connecticut. I mean, he portrayed Steven Tyler with the scarves and everything on a broomstick. But anyway, we were leaving one of their parties, and we're walking out in the hallway. And the hallway was empty because, you know, these parties were late at night. And there were two guys walking in. And Peter starts talking to one of them, and the other one is, like, bouncing off the walls. And it turned out to be Mick Jagger, and he's talking to Ronnie Wood. So Ronnie introduced us, you know, to Mick. Eventually Mick, you know, straightened up and you know, I mean, he was already partying. He was already flying. I don't even know if he made it up to the party because we left. As far as most people, we really didn't get to meet. Believe it or not, I met a lot more famous people with my second husband, because my second husband, his best friend was Ian Hunter from Mott the Hoople.
Oh,
so he was British, and you know, the thing is, the Brits kind of know each other. And,
yeah.
And I met a lot more, not just with him, but I met, you know, Keith Richards. I met Jimmy and Robert and Pete Townsend. You know, I wound up meeting a lot. You know, we went to more more popular things. Like, we went to the Arms concert. I mean, backstage at the Arms concert, it was like one famous person after another. I mean, not that I met them all, but I was like, my mouth was, you know, my jaw dropped. You know, like, oh my God, I can't believe it's like, I mean, Eric Clapton, Jimmy Page, Jeff Beck, and, you know, all on the same stage at one point. Bill Wyman, Billy Joel. I mean, it was crazy. It was, you know, it was just an amazing, amazing show, that particular one. But like I said, I did meet more famous people with my second husband. I mean, then I met Paul McCartney by myself, which I went back to work like a little 12-year-old girl. Oh, I met Paul.
Yeah. Well, how cool would that be? I mean, you know, that's awesome.
I actually kissed him.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. You know, he was fine. It's another story. I knew he was going to be somewhere, and I waited for him, and it was just me and one other guy that was waiting for him. And, you know, he signed my, I brought the white album with me, and he signed it, and the guy brought Abbey Road. So he signed Abbey Road, and then he's shaking hands with the guy, and I go, wait a minute, I didn't get a handshake. So I shook his hand, and I pulled him towards me, and I kissed him on the cheek, and he goes, that's not a handshake. I says, I know.
Oh, what a cool story.
That's a great story.
Well, Lydia, we appreciate you taking the time to sit down with us here. It's been almost 2 hours.
Wow.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. See, it just happens. Right. Boom.
No, I appreciate this a lot. This was so great. You know, we covered a lot more than just the little time period we wanted to, but I think it's just hard to stay and talk just about a 1 or 2 year period when you experience so much.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I had a good time, and I appreciate you having me on.
Thank you so much. And as always, everybody, go to lydiacriss.com. You will not be disappointed with her book.
No, it's unbelievable, people.
It's the best.
Wow, thank you so much.
Yeah, shame on you if you don't own it.
Seriously, it's got it. The pictures in Lydia's book put the pictures in KISS-try to shame, in my opinion.
I agree. Yeah, absolutely.
And it doesn't cost you $150 or whatever KISS-try cost. And the and the binding doesn't fall apart.
Yeah, the binding
right. You can't even find KISS-try anymore, right?
I don't know. Gene's probably got a few in a warehouse somewhere to sell.
He's waiting.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, they're stacked up with the monster books.
Those monster books.
Ouch. Ouch. Ouch.
Again, Lydia, thank you so much. We appreciate you taking the time.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Take care. Okay.
Bye. Yeah, bye-bye.
That was so much fun.
Mm-hmm.
It, you know, again, here's another example of a guest who we are having on that you learn something new from. There was so much stuff she talked about that I'd never heard before.
Where Paul Stanley got the name Paul.
Yeah, that was kind of cool.
Why? What?
I mean, I don't know. Had you ever heard that?
I didn't know that.
I didn't know that.
What Gene's comment was about what got KISS to Japan in 77?
Mm-hmm.
Death.
And the fact that there's footage from the plane that no one's seen.
Yeah, but Mark's known about it, of course.
Well, knowing about it and having it are two different things.
Well, I didn't know about it.
So how was that?
I never knew about
Mick
it.
Mick Jagger bouncing off walls. That's cool, too.
Well, and that's the kind of stuff that you like looking for, you know?
No, that was a very fun interview. Lydia was totally cool. I love just getting the insight as, you know, what it was like being married to Peter and dealing with the success that then came with Alive. It's pretty cool.
One of my favorite segments was the fact that something that I brought up to a friend recently. We all know the infamous inside of Kiss Alive 2 with the flames and how cool that is. I think if you look in the Monster Tour book, there's the guys out on the cherry pickers and the spiders there and the big – that's every bit as cool. And to have the original drummer's wife go, that spider stage was fucking cool.
Yeah.
she saw it from the beginning, and for her to even go there I thought was freaking awesome, because guys, KISS is all this, and take it from Lydia, she saw KISS many years later and was still blown away. How awesome is that? That speaks volumes about, you know, why we do this podcast. It's all good, man. And
the fact, you know, that she has to do double and triple takes when she sees Eric to determine if that's Eric or Peter.
Yeah, that was good too.
That. And plus, I got a piece of information that I've argued with. Look, she's known Peter since 1966. He didn't play in a jazz combo. He's never played jazz in a band as far as she knew. There's no recordings. You can be a fan of something, doesn't mean that's how you play, so, or played that kind of music. So that's, there you go, right from someone who's been there from the beginning.
Yep.
So homework. Get out there and support her if you don't have it.
Yeah, get her book. Get her book for
that's,
sure.
That's first part of homework. Go get her book.
Homework question.
What did you learn that was new that you didn't know before? You know, and that's always a good one as far as I'm concerned, because there's always stuff you're learning that, you know, you had never heard before. You know, and, or if you own Lydia's book, what's your favorite thing about it, or what is it that makes it a great book? You know, let's focus on Lydia this week.
Definitely. And I loved hearing the story of Beth from her.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just hearing her give us all of the details was just really cool.
Let's face it, Gene and Paul have said publicly that Peter didn't write that or had such a tiny bit to do with it. She just confirmed that. She even helped with a line, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to dispute that when she was pretty adamant about that. You know what I mean?
I love, you know, it's like, when did this song become about you? I don't know. It was never about me. It's sort of like, there's another manufactured story in KISS-tory.
Yeah, you learn as you get older how many of them there were.
Yeah, and it doesn't make it any more exciting and interesting. I still love it just as much.
Absolutely.
All right, guys, you know where to go with your homework. Facebook.com/threesidesofthecoin, threesidesofthecoin.com, YouTube, Spreaker, we're everywhere. Go leave us your comments. Hit us up. We want to know what you think.
Yep. Thank you for the support.
I don't know. We probably have a special guest next week. I don't know. Got to look at the calendar.
Okay.
We'll figure it out next Tuesday. We'll figure it out next Tuesday. That's it. Three sides. We're out.
Okay.
Want to get your official Three Sides of the Coin logo and shocker tee? Now you can. We ship worldwide. Get yours online at shop.threesidesofthecoin.com.
For interviews and media inquiries, contact Izzy at izzypresleyproductions.com.
Download your free copy of the KISS School of Marketing.
11 lessons I learned working with KISS.
The number one downloaded business book on Noisetrade. Go to books.noisetrade.com/Michael Brandvold.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
So you love the show. Go to itunes.threesidesofthecoin.com and leave your review and rating of Three Sides of the Coin. Thanks.